Good morning. Can everyone hear me? Great. What a beautiful, beautiful morning. We don't want to make anyone that's watching from their living room jealous, but it's 69 degrees right now. Just looked at the weather. So if it's 68 in your home, it's warmer out here today, and what a beautiful sunny day. We are going to have some meetings this week about whether or not we are able to go back inside of the building. The council will be meeting on Thursday, and we're going to go over the surveys and check in to see how people are feeling. If you've got any new information you would like to share, any ideas or comments, please call Cheryl before Thursday so we can discuss that during the council meeting. We'll be meeting at 6 o'clock on Thursday night via Zoom. We met this week and talked about Advent and the 4 weeks of Advent and how we are going to be able to communicate through that time and share each Sunday, each week of Advent. We will celebrate Christmas and we will celebrate Advent one way or another. We have got Pastor Turner would like to be able to meet and greet each person today. And so instead of just straight exiting out the driveway that way, she will be standing over by the cross, and we would like the cars to come through here, and you can say hi and then go out that way. So if you were not directed earlier, that is how we're going to be dismissed today. So you can say hi and be able to meet Pastor Turner. She's excited to meet everyone, and if you would like to make a phone call and set something up, her number is on the website to be able to contact her. Just go to the staff tab at the top or call the church office. We'll be sending out more information on how to communicate with her shortly. We have got a couple of prayers, like the Bell family would like us to continue to pray for them, and the Heron family. We still need to continue to pray for Jack as he works through this first surgery and prepares for the second. And the family was very, very pleased with the contribution that we made to help with his medical expenses. I sent out the thank you email, and if you received it, you can tell they were very, very grateful for our support. So that's all I have for this week.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. O God of justice and love, you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light we need and awaken us to the needs of others. through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Chapter. In the days of Amos, people thought that the day of the Lord would be a time of great victory. But Amos announced that it would be a day of darkness, not light. He said liturgy is no substitute for obedience. The Lord demands justice and righteousness in the community. Alas, for you who desire the day of the Lord. Why do you want the day of the Lord? It is darkness, not light, as if someone fled from a lion. It was met by a bear, or went into the house and rested a hand against the wall and was bitten by a snake. Is not the day of the Lord darkness, not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I despise your festivals, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the offerings of well-being of your fatted animals, I will not look upon. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians, 4th chapter. Some of the Thessalonians are worried that dead Christians will be excluded from the resurrection to eternal life when Christ comes again. Paul reassures them with the word of hope that all Christians, living or dead, will be raised into everlasting life with Christ. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others who do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with the cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the first sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words.
Good morning, everyone. So, kiddos, I wonder if you guys know what it means to be prepared or to be ready for something. So when I was thinking about this, the first thing I thought about was school. Because most of us go to school, right? And we've got to be ready for school. We've got to be prepared. You've got to have your backpack filled with your books, and you need pencils and coloring stuff. You need paper. You need all kinds of stuff. You need your lunch. Sometimes you need a snack. You get hungry at school. If you don't have any of those things, you're not going to be prepared, right? Or if you have a test coming up, sometimes you have to study, like those spelling tests, right? We've got to practice those spelling words. Or when we go play outside. Today, we're pretty lucky. We could go outside and we'd be just fine. I don't even have a coat on today. But it's getting to be winter, right? So if we're going to go out and play in the snow, we need a coat and we need winter boots. We need a scarf and mittens or gloves to keep us warm when we're outside, or we're going to get really cold and we're not going to be able to throw very many snowballs at our parents, right? So we got to be really prepared, get all bundled up. Jesus does a lot of amazing things that we learn about. And Easter was, you know, a while ago, but when we think back to Easter, Jesus does something really amazing. And we always talk about it when we say, he is risen. And then we always respond with, he is risen indeed, exactly. So at Easter, we talk about how Jesus died on the cross. But 3 days later, Jesus rises from the dead. It was an amazing miracle. And Jesus is going to do another amazing miracle. Jesus is going to come again. It's not something we always talk about, especially in our Sunday school class, but Jesus is going to come again. We're going to have another amazing miracle. But we don't know when it's going to happen. It could happen in 100 years. It could happen tomorrow. It could happen in 100 years. We don't know. So one thing we need to do is be prepared for when Jesus comes again. Just like we have to be prepared to go play in the snow or to go to school. So some of the things we can do to be prepared for when Jesus comes again is to pray. We can pray to God and pray to Jesus. We can read our Bibles. It's got a lot of good stories in there. And we can love God like we learned about in the last couple weeks, with all our heart, with all our minds, and with all our soul, right? And to love our neighbors. And remember, we're learning that our neighbors aren't just the people that live next door or the people in the car next to you. It's everyone across the whole world. They're all our neighbors, and we have to love them all. So in our lesson that we just read, we talk about having hope too. So sometimes we're getting ready for Jesus to come again. But what about all those saints that we learned about last week? It was All Saints Sunday, right? All the saints, all the Christians that came before us. And we learn in that second lesson we just heard that all of the Christians, all of the saints, they're all gonna join us in that everlasting kingdom too. So we can have hope that we're all gonna be together. We're all gonna be together with Jesus in the everlasting kingdom once Jesus comes again. So we can be very hopeful and encouraged that we're all gonna be together again. All right, so pray with me. Dear Jesus, thank you for loving us and for bringing us hope, that we will be together with you and all of our Christian family. Help us to prepare our hearts for when we will join you in your everlasting kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
Our Holy Gospel is taken today from Matthew, the 25th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, 'Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out and meet him.' Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise replied, 'No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves.' And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he replied, 'Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour.'" This is the gospel of our Lord. Peace to you, Christ. One of the things that typically comes to mind for me when I read the part of our gospel about the bridegroom being late is how one of my aunts was always late. So much so, we would sometimes tell her a time that to come that was an hour or so before she actually needed to be there. So she would come somewhat on time. Our running joke in our family was that she would even be late to her own funeral. Somehow, over the years, my sister also inherited the lateness gene. For someone like myself, who spent many of my early years around my grandfather, whose motto was that to be on time was to be late, so you always needed to be early, I could never understand how those family members would come when it worked for them. I imagine they tried their best to be on time, but it never seemed to work out for them. Our gospel lesson for today shows another side of lateness, though. Instead of highlighting the tardy bridegroom, the focus is more on the need to always be ready and always prepared, and with that, to have a bit of patience. It is true we don't always know what is to come, especially in this year, 2020. And it is hard to always be ready or patient, but we are called to try our best. Today, on this 23rd week of Pentecost, whether we are someone who gets to our destination early, on time, or slightly late, we are all invited to slow down and focus on being prepared. It is hard to believe it, but in 3 weeks, we will be at the start of Advent once again. It is during that season that we get more reminders to keep alert, to keep awake, to be ready for that day when our Lord will appear. And maybe because it sometimes takes more than once to get things to stick, we start hearing those reminders today. "Keep awake, for you do not know the day or the hour," Jesus says. Hold on a minute, we might say. I don't think we can keep awake all the time. We would walk around like a bunch of zombies, or at the very least, be very unproductive. Jesus, this is one thing that is impossible for us to do. The people in the days of the Bible weren't much better at figuring out what Jesus meant either. There was one set of people, the disciples and others who overheard Jesus' words that day, when he first gave the admonition to keep alert and be ready, who really may have wondered what he was telling them. Jesus was talking about his second coming, and yet there he was, standing right in front of them. Sure, he had told them time and time again how he would go to the cross, but at this point they were still hoping it wouldn't actually happen. So maybe they thought this time what Jesus said didn't really apply for them. On the other hand, there was another group of people who would look back on his words many years later, or in some cases, just a few months later. They were the ones who had witnessed the death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus, and they were more fearful than ever. They heard Jesus would come again someday, but it wasn't clear when that day would be, and it wasn't laid out in perfect detail how he would do it and what would be expected of them, except that they had to be ready. Along the way, there were some false starts, where they thought, this must be it, only to find out it was someone trying to lead them astray. They knew they had to be ready, but how? That question remains for us today. We too have heard the charge to keep awake, to be ready, to keep our lamps trimmed and oil ready. Our reaction may be that is all well and good, but how can we be ready for something that we don't know? Waiting for something that is way overdue, waiting for something you're not even sure will actually come, waiting that involves active preparation, even if you aren't sure what you should be preparing for. That kind of waiting is extra challenging. And to make things even more difficult, while we wait, we aren't supposed to just sit around looking at each other either. We are to do God's work in the meantime. And perhaps it is through our work that we get a glimpse of what it means to be ready for God's kingdom. For each one of us, our definition of being prepared through active waiting will be different. But we are called to do so in the best way that we know how. There are countless things we can do as we wait. We are those who help to celebrate the success achieved by our brothers and sisters in Christ. We are those who can offer comfort and support after disappointments. We can help to bring hope when hope is scarce and courage in times of fear. We can help each other to wait, to prepare, to keep the faith. And through it all, we can encourage each other with the promises of Christ. We know that one day Christ will come again. Some will be alive yet on earth, and others alive in the heavenly places, already with God. When that will be, God only knows. Although some have tried, rather unsuccessfully thus far, to figure it out. In the meantime, we are those who do Christ's work here on earth, each in our own way. We keep awake in Christ, having our minds and hearts focused on Him. As we wait, we come together in a community of believers. Whether that community is gathered virtually or gathered here in your cars to share in the meal that Jesus gave to all who believe. And we help one another be patient, to slow down, to put away watches and cell phone clocks, to simply be present in the moment. We prepare by learning all that God has for us to learn. And then one day, we will be like those who rose and trimmed their lamps, lighting up the house for all to see the coming of Christ, invited into the wedding banquet that has no end. Amen.
Oh,
longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all who are in need. Holy God, rouse us to deep praise as we gather for worship. Enliven our worship with sincere and heartfelt song. Sustain the work of all church musicians and artists who lead us in praise and prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Creator, surprise and delight us with the beauty of the world you have made. Bless the work of landscapers, architects, and artists, whose work invites us into harmonious being with your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Judge, let justice roll down like waters over this world. Reign over the courtrooms of every land, in the hearts of those who guard the law and those who stand accused of crimes. Be present in cases where we long for both justice and mercy to prevail. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Companion, console those who feel lonely or abandoned. Share the hours of those who live or eat alone. Comfort those who have few friends or who struggle with their identity and place in this world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Protector, be with all observing Veterans Day. Guard the lives of active duty and retired military personnel. Comfort all who mourn those who have died in the line of duty. Heal the wounds, both physical and mental, experienced by service members. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy and immortal One, we pray in thanksgiving for the lives of all who have died. Remind us of the frailty and shortness of our own lives, and inspire us to use them for the building up of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive the prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. Amen. God of all goodness, generations have turned to you, gathered around your table, and shared your abundant blessings. Number us among them, that as we gather our own gifts from your abundance, we may give thanks for your rich blessings and care for all that you have made. We give you thanks, Holy God, through Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, whom you sent in this end of the ages to save and redeem us, proclaiming your reign of peace and promising an end to injustice and harm. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, the sacrifice of his life and death, and the victory of his resurrection, we await with all the saints his loving redemption of our suffering world. Send your spirit on the gifts of bread and wine, and on all who share in the body and blood of your Son. Teach us your mercy and justice, and make all things new in Christ. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As you share in communion today, know that the body of Christ is given for you, and the blood of Christ is shed for you. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Let pray.